So, yeah, as you guys saw, I just made a quick little nostalgic deadlift montage that I uploaded on my Instagram with some cool music behind it if you guys want to check it out with some music. But, yeah, I mean, deadlifts were my favorite movement to do for the longest time until I basically injured my back and I wasn't really able to do them. As you guys saw earlier on, especially with a lighter weight, like my back was like rounding, my form definitely wasn't good, and as the weight increased, it kind of improved over time, and I didn't actually injure my back deadlifting. I injured my back through some weird static hold exercise that I did back in the day, and I just never actually let it fully heal, and now it's actually starting to get a lot better, which is why I'm able to squat again, and I'm gonna transition back into deadlifting. But honestly, just making that little segment that really, really, really inspires me to like get back into it as soon as I possibly can, because I was pretty sad for a long period of time, only being able to really do bench like properly and passionately. But now that I can kind of start doing squats again, my feeling my back strengthen up a little bit, when I can start deadlifting again, I'm gonna be pulling some very, very heavy objects. So yeah, that's that. I just wanted to give a little trailer for what's coming up soon with the deadlifts. And another thing that I just want to mention is that Gymshark, they've been working on an app for a very, very, very long period of time. It was supposed to launch like a year ago. The date kept getting pushed back because there's lots of revisions that had to be made, like a lot of like issues that came in the way. But it's finally live. You guys can click a link down in the description to check it out. And if you guys want to pay for the premium service, then you'll be able to get some of my workout plans that I made, every other Gymshark athletes, and there's also just a lot of other cool things on there. But to get the app, of course, it's free, so you guys can check that out. That's really, really cool. So now I'm going to continue off the video with a voiceover that me and James made with some workout footage over the past few days.
All right, so I just want to say that we're recording a voiceover right now, and this is our second attempt. Our first attempt, we were just all tired, just like no energy at all.
Shit wasn't flowing correctly. Words weren't forming. Sentences weren't forming.
It was just very low resolution, real bad. So we decided to go for a quick little 10-minute run, you know, get some endorphins flowing. So here we are. So basically right
now.
Out
of breath, but at least our brains are working correctly.
Yeah, so you're going to have to excuse my few massive gasps for air. But yeah, we just have a lot of workout footage in front of here, in front of us, in the timeline over the past few days. And I just want to say that, as you guys saw in my last video, I was in Georgia, the country Georgia. Whoa, just almost died there real quick. Speaking
almost
of almost dying, when I was in Georgia, it was for my grandfather's birthday, the country Georgia. And literally the day before flying out, I got the most catastrophic virus in my stomach, like imaginable. I was like diarrhea, vomiting. It was so bad. I got sent to the emergency room, and they pumped like 4 or 5 bags of like saline, like an IV in me, just to get like some nutrients, some potassium, some electrolytes, because I literally would have died of dehydration. That's how bad it was. But luckily, I made it alive, and I also made it alive through that 275, and here I am. Damn, look at this 315 right here. That just went up real smooth. So yeah, when I got sick, I didn't eat for like
335.
Clean 335 right there. But yeah, I didn't eat for like 50, 60 hours. So I completely flattened out. So this is pretty much my first workout coming home. And the whole purpose of it was just kind of get some blood flowing, get some glycogen back. I try to see how heavy I can go. I stopped at 275. I was having a hard time keeping my lats tight, so I just compromised and just went down to a nice, clean, respectable 245 for 5 sets of 5, really focusing on keeping them lats tight.
Yep, and I did a 3x5 with 295 paused.
Yeah, this was clean. This is a very powerful press.
I'm actually very surprised by this because I haven't really been training consistently at all. Also, I haven't been training legs due to a groin injury, which is not unlike me at all because my legs always get injured. But I've noticed there's a correlation between my upper body strength and my leg strength. So even if I'm training upper regularly, if I'm not training legs, shit just doesn't fire correctly and I'm not as strong because of it.
So pretty much here, we're doing some standing OHP. I personally wanted to do seated OHP because that's my personal preference, even though I objectively understand that standing OHP, full range of motion, is just superior for the delt all around, or just a way better movement. James kind of checkmate swindled me into it, so here we are. Haven't done it in a while, so here I'm just trying to do 135 for like a few sets of 8, and I think James did like 10 or 12 or something like that. But
proper shoulder abduction on standing, you know that. Come on.
Yeah, but you know, there's just something a little bit more just kind of romantic about doing it seated. Little extra arch, more upper chest engagement, a little bit more weight, ego a little happier, you know what I mean? Like, just take the edge off. But James, why are you're in Boston, New York? Like, why are you here in Jersey training Island Gym? What are you doing here?
I'm a nowhere man. I'm an everywhere man.
A nomad.
Traveling all around. So, I mean, basically, yeah, been living in New York for the summer, which is just a short bus ride away from New Jersey. So, along with generally having somewhat of a liking for David Lade, he is considered my acquaintance, I guess.
To say the least.
Besides for that, basically just noticed like communication is tough for the whole coaching thing that we launched. And because we're like FaceTiming back and forth about specific clients and just keeping up with everything when we first launch it over the phone, which is just generally harder. So I decided to just pack my shit real quick and come down to New Jersey.
Yeah, because when we first set everything up, like, we were together for a pretty decent chunk of time. So it was easy back and forth in person, just organized, set everything up. And then we pretty much split ways, and then we launched it while being in separate locations. I mean, everything went smoothly. Everything's going great, but it's just a lot more ideal and a lot more fluid when we're both together. So that's kind of one of the main reasons James is here. We just got it all ironed out. But another thing that I want to say on the coaching is, obviously, the $350 price tag is a lot of the majority of your guys' budgets, and we completely understand that, and we actually thought about that a lot. So in the future, in the very near future, we're going to be offering a much, much, much more affordable option, where it's basically a fully customized program and literally just that. So you're not going to be getting like any one-on-one communication, nothing like that. It's exclusively a program, and it's going to be like a fraction of the price, like something really affordable if you guys don't want to do the $350, which is completely understandable.
Because there are some people, like especially aspiring influencers, like people who are growing their following, but or really aspire to make it in the fitness industry, that really benefit from the social media coaching and all that kind of stuff, and like the daily communication, the, you know, video consultation, everything like that. But then there are other people that, you know, have a job or going to college for something else, and they're not looking to be a fitness influencer, but obviously they really enjoy the gym and they want like a fully customized program. They don't want a cookie cutter program. So basically the other option that we'll be offering, as Dave said, will be just the programming, the customized programming, without all the other stuff. And it'll be a similar kind of questionnaire where we can fully evaluate what you need in terms of a program. And, you know, you might already have like your form in check, all that kind of stuff, and your technique in check, and you simply don't need to be coached through that. But you're having trouble sifting through, you know, is this cookie cutter program good for me, or is this cookie cutter program good for me? Now, essentially what the customized programming is going to be is like, you're going to fill out the questionnaire, as I said, and then based on that, it's going to ask very pointed questions like, in which part of each main lift do you struggle with? Is it the lockout? Is it off the bottom of the movement? Which muscle groups are you looking to improve? What kind of injuries do you have? And then based on that, we can build you a program. And I mean, a lot of you might not have experience with like customized one-on-one programming. So basically what it is it's different from cookie cutter in the sense that it's not just that it's optimized for you, but it's also that each block builds on the last block. So each like 4-week training block builds on the last one, and the exercise selection changes based on what weaknesses you have, and the sets and reps and the weight you're using changes based on the previous block. It's not just like a thing where you buy it once and then you simply repeat it as many times as necessary. It's like a recurring thing where you know, you stay in it for many months at a time, and then eventually it's a massive peak and taper and go for new maxes.
And one of the things that we basically learned from the one-on-one coaching so far is that going off one rep max to assess writing in the exact weight to use on a program isn't exactly the best gauge, because someone could say that, oh, my bench max is 350, because at some point back in the day, like 6 months ago, when there were peak strength and like their school, they didn't have that much schoolwork to do. They were training all out. They were sleeping so much every night, eating a massive surplus of calories, and they managed to swindle 350 off their chest. But now that that's not the case anymore, realistically, they can only press maybe 315, 310, 320 off their chest. When they're hit with a questionnaire to say, what's your one rep max? The ego's gonna kind of kick in, and they're
I can totally hit 350.
Yeah, and the thing is, they're not wrong. Yeah, they are a person that have hit that max before, but
they're not at that current level of strength. Yeah. So what me and Dave basically discovered, like, more and more is that, wow, like, especially RPE based on the first week, but potentially even RPE based for the entire program, is just simply better, because attempting to fill in the exact weight someone should use, it's literally just better to leave it up to the client, because, you know, it's like if Dave were to say, oh yeah, my bench max is 390, when that was when he was in like a massive surplus and just training was going consistently. Now he just got Ebola in Georgia, like lost a bunch of muscle mass and has, you know, trouble with 315. It wouldn't be realistic to give him a bench triple with 345. He'd simply fail, because reading it off the screen, oh, 390 bench will give him a triple with 345 at RP8 or whatever, and that's simply not going to happen. Versus if we say, okay, we want you to hit a bench triple and we want you to aim for a weight that's going to be RP8, the client is going to be more realistic with their current level of strength and actually choose a weight that is going to be RP8.
Yeah, and RPEs are just all around honestly just superior in this case, because it really, really depends on the day. Once you become very intuitive and learn how to use RPEs, it just kind of trumps everything, because you'll show up to a gym and you could be in peak circumstances one day and the program says, okay, hit 3 reps at RPE 9, you'll be able to pick like a weight that is pretty much a PR for you, something really substantial. Or you can come in the gym in another day with the exact same circumstances, hit a set of 3 at RPE 9, and you slept that much that night, you don't have enough food, right? Clearly you can't go off percentages and hit what you would theoretically be able to based off percentages, because percentages are going under the presupposition that you're in ideal conditions all the time, but that's simply not practical whatsoever. So you're going to go off RPE inside, okay, realistically, what could I hit this day? Because that way you're not going to be failing and you're going to be hitting your volume, because volume is absolutely key.
Yeah, because if we see, you know, if someone's getting great sleep and they're eating great and they come in and they hit a, you know, a bench triple at RP8, then we're going to see that. And for that same day next week, we might increase the weight 10 pounds, expecting that it might go up to RP8.5. But then turns out the next week, they're kind of sleeping like 4 hours a night. They're not really eating food like they should be. They're not taking mobility seriously. And suddenly what should be an RP 8.5 single triple turns into an RP 10 triple. So overall, RP rules. And just to touch on what RP is, because we've been talking about it for a while now, it stands for rate of perceived exertion. And it's not some arbitrary scale from 1 to 10 of how hard a set is. There's a method you can go about evaluating what your RPE was on a certain set. So basically you can think about it like RP 10 is max exertion, obviously, no weight left in the tank, no reps left in the tank. RPE 9 is one rep left in the tank. So you could have done one more rep and then that would have been failure. RP 8 is 2 reps left in the tank. RPE 7 is 3 reps left in the tank. So a lot of the times we're doing back accessories and stuff, it's realistically like less than RPE 6. Because we're just, you know, we're rowing this dumbbell. And yeah, it's a tough set, but if we really needed to, we could have pulled it for many more reps. But if we're doing heavy deadlifts or, you know, heavy squats, that's when RPE is really important, because it's like, no, I literally couldn't have hit more than 2 reps extra on that specific set.
Yeah, so we're going to give a lot more information, obviously, of course, in the future about this, and we're going to have a full intricate breakdown of RPE. Right now, it's just like a quick low-resolution summary, but yeah, we're going to have more information on that in the future. But as you guys see right here, this is a different workout than how the video started off. We just went to the gym, did a little upper body. Then the next day, I hit legs. James wasn't able to because his groin snapped up. And here, James is doing a little folliculitis rose. He's got a weird skin infection where it's not acne, but it really, really looks like acne. But what's happening is that apparently the skin follicle is like weird, misfiring, not aligned, all postmodern, like snapped
it's
up.
It's just
like,
fucked up. Basically, folliculitis. I don't even know how the fuck you get it, honestly. but it's just inflammation of hair follicles. It's very ambiguous. And I went to the dermatologist for it, and she was like, yeah, it's probably just folliculitis, and gave me some sort of cream, which did jack shit. And it's essentially just like little red marks all over my skin. It's really annoying, honestly, kind of making me insecure, but hopefully that shit gets cleared up soon. I want my beautiful skin back.
Yeah, speaking of insecurities, if you guys assess my level of intramuscular glycogen retention here, it's approximately RPE zero. So, yeah, I mean, like I said, I think I fasted for like at least 50 or 60 hours when I got that weird Ebola thing in Georgia. So now I'm just like recovering from that, like trying to like get back up to 200 with the calories. And we did a very, very high volume back day here. This is actually today, the day that we're like doing this record voiceover. And I think up to this point right now, we filmed every single set just to show you guys like what a typical full workout would look like for us when we're not strictly on program. We're kind of living like semi-hectically, but how a training session would look like, both of us trying to kind of get back in the groove. You know, James injured, he's got his fucking folliculitis bullshit, like all my glycogen is all snapped up.
But couple of dilapidated fucking elderly men, seriously.
Yeah, so
I miss the glory days, aka like 1 month ago in Manchester when training was fucking going well. We looked amazing. Honestly, now we got all this skin shit going on, glycogen, lack of retention, just weakness
for me,
all around.
I'm just so happy that I could do squats again, because when I was in Georgia, I was only able to lift two times. I remember one of the times I left the house with like a GPS that was like half working, and I ended up walking around 2 hours. I couldn't get into a gym. I couldn't find a gym. But the only two times I did train, I like squatted. And I know a lot of people hate squats, but right now I absolutely adore them. I just haven't been able to do them so long. It just feels real, real nice. And speaking of things that feel real, real nice and are real, real nice, Gymshark, at the moment of this upload, is already hosting their Labor Day sale. And I'm pretty sure not all of the items, but an overwhelming majority of them are up to 30% off on the site. So if you guys just want to use my link down in the description box, you could save yourself a couple dollars on some Gymshark items. And if you want to go off any of my personal recommendations, the Recess joggers, and particularly the Recess hoodie, are like hands down one of my favorite things that they're making right now. And in the beginning of this video, you see that I'm wearing a black pair of pants that has like a white stripe down the side. Those are the Recess joggers, and the hoodie is like just as good, if not better. There's just something about it that like is this weird German track athlete archetype. Like it just like it fits real good, like shoulders real wide. Like I just highly, highly recommend it. So that's that. And speaking
of my folliculitis pull downs,
got some folliculitis pull downs, but at least you're wearing your shirt correctly. It's outside in, meaning that, is that right? Outside in? Basically, you're wearing it correctly. If you look
I
at
think
my
it's
shirt,
it's outside out.
Oh, it's outside out.
Inside. I think outside in is just a different way to say inside out.
I'm just trying to work around it. But yeah, now if you look at this, this is inside out. I just realized I have my tag sticking out just behind me. My shirt was literally inside out this whole time.
Actually, I'm pretty sure it was outside in.
Outside in, inside out. I mean, at this point, I have no idea. I think we need to go on another like 5 minute run outside.
I think we need to sprint for like half an hour straight to wake ourselves up.
My
right
norepinephrine and dopamine are just being re-uptook and like real, real bad. Oh, I can't. Yeah, so
that's the voiceover.
Yeah, that's the voiceover. And over here, you know what's crazy? I noticed out of every single muscle group that deflated for me after that Ebola, my traps became absolutely absent, non-existent, black hole, vacant, obliterated, decimated.
Like, I'm looking at them right now. Oh, boy.
You could see them? You could actually see them. That's really, really impressive.
Bit. I pulled out my magnifying glass.
So, yeah, I mean, I just finished off with, like, a few sets of shrugs, and at some point I think after the dumbbell rows when we were doing a lot of pull downs, I stopped filming every set because the shit was just getting excessive. And I just did some curls after this that I didn't film because my SD card was misbehaving. And then if you look over here, here's just two low resolution primates right now pending final completion. And yeah, that's that.
You have a properly tanned man on the left. Oh, now you have a properly tanned man on the right.
It is what it is.
And then overexposure on the left.